We are one step from programming the core logic of heating substation, valve and circulation pumps control. But first, we need to figure out where do we get temperature set points from and what the temperature graph is. First, which set points are we talking about? Well, there is a control loop of valve KV1, where process value comes from supply water temperature. There is also pumps 1 and 2 control loop, where process value comes from return water temperature. As you can see, both control loops must get set points somewhere. In many cases, temperature graph is used for that purpose. Basically, it is a table where for each ambient temperature value, there are corresponding temperature 1 and 2 values. Turns out that T1 is desired temperature of supplied water and T2 is desired return water temperature. If you put ambient temperature on the x-axis and T1, T2 on the y-axis and connect the points, you'll get the temperature graph, or to be precise, two graphs. Where does it come from and why do we use exactly these values? Well, HVAC guys could give you a longer story, but shorter version is there are different versions of this graph, like 9070 or 9570, for different types of buildings, pipes, and different geographies. Anyway, let's get to work. Before writing any code, I want to clean up the project tree a bit. Add the folder resources and move structure, variable lists, function block, and function there. Looks much cleaner, isn't it? Now, you already know the drill. Add a POU, select function, return type could be anything, and for implementation language, select structure text. Name it something like temp graph 8060. Why ST language, you may ask? Well, you can try to do the same with language of your choice, and then in the end, we can compare the result. Deal? Let's get into it. As an input, the function will take ambient temperature value with real time, of course. As an output, create T1 and T2 variables with real type as well. Next step, we need to represent our graph somehow. Since we already have two tables, the easiest way to represent them would be an array. By definition, array is a collection of data elements of the same data type. And that's exactly what we have here. Run auto configuration wizard, flag it as a constant, since we won't be changing it. Put in some meaningful name and instead of putting some elementary type, select array wizard. You can do multi-dimensional arrays, but in our case it's a table with just one column, so one dimension all we need. Usually you would see starting index 0 or 1, and then the end index something like 33 in our case, right? But we can actually use any integer type numbers. So let's play it clever and use values of ambient temperature from the table. -22 to 10. Base type would be real, of course. Now you need to initialize the array with values. So you can see array elements with their respective index. For ambient temperature -22, T1 would be 80, for -21, T1 is 78, then 77, and so on. Once you're done, hit OK, and OK again, and you'll have your array declared and initialized. Now, for T2 array, you can copy-paste declaration and change initial values or do the same procedure one more time. If you have two or more of the same values in a row, Automation Builder may use shorter representation. Here you have 48 twice. You can rewrite it as a 2 and then the value in parentheses. This will have absolutely the same meaning. Let's change it back. Okay, now everything is ready to write the logic. First, you need to cover the boundary conditions. What if temperature lower than -22 degrees or higher than 10 degrees? We don't have that kind of values in a table. To check any condition in ST language, there is an if statement. Just type if, then expression which gives back Boolean type result. It could be comparison, Boolean variable, or combined expression with logical operators. In this case, you compare ambient temperature with minus 22. If it's the case, temp is lower than minus 22 degrees, then everything until and if keyword will be executed. In this case, we just give outputs RT1 and RT2 the same values as with minus 22 degrees. Type the name of the variable which you want to assign value to, then assignment operator, and then value to be assigned. You could have typed just value 80, but to make code more readable, put array name with index minus 22 in square brackets. This would mean code to array element number minus 22 and get its value. The same goes for T2. Next, you need to cover values above 10 degrees. It could be done by adding another if statement or by adding one more condition to the existing if statement. Type else if before end if. This means if first condition is not satisfied, this one will be checked. And if it's true, then just copy-paste from the first condition and change the index to 10. And what if it's neither of those two? Well, that means that ambient temperature value falls into the range minus 22 to 10 degrees. That's exactly what we're after here. Problem is that we only have values in discrete points, minus 20, minus 19, and so on. In reality, temperature will always lie somewhere in between those points. But if we take those points and connect them one after another, we suddenly get a bunch of lines, which we already dealt with when we did analog I/O scaling. As a reminder, if we have two points on a plane with coordinates x0, y0 and x1, y1, and a point in between with coordinates x, y, then given value of x, value of y could be calculated with the following formula. All we need to do is to check in which segment lies ambient temperature and then do some fairly simple math. There's even a fancy name for this method: piecewise linear interpolation. Back to function. If you'd like to run some code in case none of the conditions satisfied, you just put else and then your code after it. Now, how do you determine in which segment temperature lies? Well, if you have to work with arrays and somehow check their elements one by one, in most cases the answer would be to use loop operators. If you have any programming background in pretty much any programming language, you're familiar with the concept. If not, a loop is used to execute a piece of code with certain number of repetitions. It'll make more sense once you see it. We will use for loop. Define a variable which will work as a loop counter and give it initial value from which loop starts repetition. In this case, it's minus 22. It's common practice to give counter variable names like I, J, K, etc. Then specify up to which value counter must come. By default, an increment is equal to 1. And after keyword do goes your code, which has to be repeated. Inside the loop, first you would need to check whether the ambient temperature lies inside the current segment. It means that we start with minus 22 and check if value is between minus 22 and minus 21. If not, then in the next iteration between minus 21 and minus 20, and so on. Add another if statement with following condition: ambient temperature is greater or equal to I, current counter value, and at the same time less than next value. If you got into the right segment, then calculate T1 using formula. In the denominator, part I and I could be cancelled out, leaving just division by 1. which doesn't change the result and may be omitted as well. Now, just duplicate this calculation for T2. And then, since you already found the right segment, you don't need to run loop till the last element. You can terminate loop execution by exit instruction. Great! It wasn't that hard, was it? Now, let's test the function. Add POU for testing, call it in PLC-PRG, and add function call along with some test input and output variables. Go to simulation, switch it to run, and you can see that it already works. 55 and 45 degrees are exactly the values of T1 and T2 with ambient temperature is zero. Change it to something like minus 30. Okay. Now, minus 22. Cool, works. Let's try 10. And indeed, it's 42 and 36. 20? Yeah. Maybe something in between, like 4.5 degrees. And that doesn't seem to be right. It works for T1, but T2 value is wrong. Values for 4 and 5 degrees ambient are both 41. So anything in between also must be 41. Let's do some debugging. In the end, as a PLC programmer, you will probably spend more time troubleshooting than writing actual code. Automation Builder has a neat step-by-step debugging feature. To activate it, you need to select a place in a program where you suspect problem might be. In this case, we know that the problem is somewhere in temp graph function call. From debug menu, toggle a breakpoint. You will see that PLC stops, but it's not a stop mode as before, it's halt on breakpoint. Important note. You generally don't want to run breakpoint debugging on PLC, which controls real process or machine. Pausing the program execution can lead to unintended behavior, breakdown, or even fatalities. So be very careful with it. If you can, just use simulation. Now that the program execution is on pause, you can either continue execution or start moving one step at a time. Select step into or press F8. Now, program pointer, this little yellow arrow, is inside the function. If you go to debug and press step into again, PLC will evaluate if condition, finds out it's false, 4.5 is indeed not less than minus 22, and jumps on the next else if statement. Press F8 again, this condition is also false. So program pointer goes to the for loop, which is under else section. One more step and loop counter is initialized. Now program checks if you are at the right part of the array. Obviously, minus 22 is far away from 4, so you need to cycle through the array again and again until you get to 4. Now, if condition returns true and program gets into formula calculations. Good, T1 is calculated properly. Jump to the next line. T2 calculation is not okay. And yeah, hopefully you already see the problem. When I pasted the second line, I forgot to change T1 to T2 in the second part of the formula. Go offline and change what you've got to change. Then to simulation again, get back to test, put value 4.5 for ambient temperature. Here we go. Let's try something like 4.6. Good. Maybe 4.9. Great. Let's leave this temp graph for now. I don't know if you tried to code this function using different language, but I did. For the sake of comparison, I tried to do the same in FBD, just to show you that it works. For 0 degrees, values are right. Now for 4.5. It is also correct. 4.9 degrees ambient temp, minus 22, exactly what we expect. Now go to function definition. Oh my goodness. And I even cheated here a little. Formula calculations on multiplexer block inputs are still done in ST. Most probably, you would be able to come up with more optimized solution, but I think I've made a point. Different languages are better suited for different tasks, even though technically you can do everything in structured text. See you guys in the next one.